Penguin Random House presents Seeing Like a Feminist by Nivedita Menon, read by Pallavi Bharti. Zuban Penguin Books, Seeing Like a Feminist. Nivedita Menon teaches political thought at Jawaharlal Nehru University, Delhi. Her previous books include Recovering Subversion, Feminist Politics Beyond the Law, 2004, an edited volume, Sexualities, 2007, and Power and Contestation, India After 1989, 2007, co-authored with Aditya Nikam. An active commentator on the blog Kafila.online, she has also translated fiction and non-fiction from Hindi and Malayalam into English. She has been active with citizens' forums in Delhi on secularism, workers and women's rights, sexuality, and in opposition to the nuclear bomb. This book has been translated into Hindi, Malayalam, Punjabi, and Spanish. A note on the 2022 edition. In this revised edition of Seeing Like a Feminist, 10 years after it was first published, I have only updated relevant information regarding crucial legal changes that have taken place in the interim, especially with regard to sexual violence and Section 377, which had criminalized same-sex desire. Were we to consider the developments on the feminist landscape over this decade with regard to the themes covered in this book, we would need another book, a volume 2, as it were, of Seeing Like a Feminist. But far better, I think, for these developments to be covered in new books by other feminists. Meanwhile, the theoretical framework of this book continues to have relevance, I believe, and I would not want to change any of it. With continued gratitude for my community of feminist friendships and solidarities cutting across generations, older and younger, for our sharp disagreements and shared perspectives, for our quarrels and our meeting halfway, for the gradual shifts in my thinking that these conversations and quarrels have enabled over my lifetime. In humility, and hoping I have the courage to be surprised and productively destabilized by fresh views and opinions till the very end, I dedicate this edition to feminists of all genders everywhere, struggling to break and to build, to create poetry and hope. Introduction. Have you heard of nude makeup? This is what it is. Nude makeup looks are all about your skin looking fresh and dewy without looking like you're even wearing any makeup. All you need is eyeliner, mascara, nude lipstick, and a highlighting blush that will give your skin a natural looking glow. The whole point of nude makeup, clearly, is to spend hours painting your face in order to make it look like you had not touched it at all. The maintaining of social order is rather like that. It requires the faithful performance of prescribed rituals over and over again throughout one's lifetime. Complex networks of cultural reproduction are dedicated to this sole purpose. But the ultimate goal of all this unceasing activity is to produce the effect of untouched naturalness. When one sees the world like a feminist, though, with the gaze of a feminist, it's rather like activating the reveal formatting function in Microsoft Word. It reveals the strenuous, complex formatting that goes on below the surface of what looked smooth and complete. What do I mean by feminism? A feminist perspective recognizes that the hierarchical organizing of the world around gender is key to maintaining social order, that to live lives marked male and female is to live different realities. But simultaneously, to be a feminist is to imagine occupying the marginal, relatively powerless position with reference to every dominant framework that swallows up the space at the center. For instance, any possible female listener of this book would be in a relatively powerful position with regard to the working class men she interacts with daily. The auto rickshaw driver, the janitor, the domestic servant, and if she's an upper caste Hindu in India or a white American anywhere, with regard to men who are not. At the same time, she would experience her relative powerlessness as a woman if faced by a man in a position to attack her sexually, regardless of his class or caste, or when she compares her life choices and autonomy with those of a man of her class. Needless to say, it is not only women who can adopt feminism as a political stance and way of life, but men who choose to do this have to take a stand against the privileges that they could otherwise take for granted. Feminism is thus not about individual men and women, but about understanding the ways in which men and women are produced and inserted into patriarchies that differ according to time and place. My title is inspired by James Scott's Seeing Like a State, but there is a crucial difference in the way seeing operates in the two instances. Scott uses the metaphor of seeing to indicate the ways in which a modern state makes heterogeneous practices legible to itself in order to control them. Thus, the state's seeing is invested with enormous power, because when it sees an identity, it is making that identity real. Its seeing is simultaneously ordering society. On the contrary, when a feminist sees from the position of marginality he or she has deliberately chosen to occupy, it is a gesture of subversion towards power. It disorganizes and disorders the settled field, resists homogenization, and opens up multiple possibilities rather than close them off. To be a feminist is to understand that different identities located hierarchically as dominant or subordinate are produced at different times and in different spaces, but also to be aware particularly of the processes of gendering. By gendering, I mean the ways in which people are produced as proper men and women through rules and regulations of different sorts, some of which we internalize, some of which have to be violently enforced. To be a feminist is to recognize that apart from gender-based injustice, there are multiple structural inequalities that underlie the social order, and to believe that change is possible and to work for it at whichever level possible. Feminism is not an organization that one formally joins, and it can never be the isolated achievement of individual women. To be a feminist is to feel part of the history that has produced us. It is to insert oneself into two centuries of thick, textured narratives of struggles and celebrations that transcends national boundaries. To hear the strains of songs of anger and sorrow and militancy in many tongues. To remember our heroines, our foremothers, and above all, to feel an enormous sense of continuing responsibility. Is this book about India? I think not. When we read Germaine Greer's The Female Eunuch, or Simone de Beauvoir's The Second Sex, or bell hooks' Feminism is for Everybody, I mention these iconic feminist texts in conjunction with mine in all humility, only because they would be familiar to many listeners. We do not assume that they are writing about Australia or France or the US. Rather, we see them as theorizing from their own location to make arguments about women and patriarchy in general. And while some of their arguments work in plural contexts, others do not. In this book, I draw on feminist scholarship and feminist politics in my part of the world to set up conversations with feminist debates and experiences globally. The key difference may be that when we in the non-West theorize on the basis of our experiences, we rarely assume that these are generalizable everywhere. But we do believe that comparisons and engagements with other feminisms are not only possible, but unavoidable. Which is why, in this book, I often assume and address the lively global feminist voices that surround us. And when I say we, I generally mean feminists. Let me reiterate, then, that my focus in this book is feminist politics and feminist ways of seeing the operation of gendered modes of power. So it is not about women in politics. In India today, the political scene is marked by fiery, independent, militant women. Medha Patkar, in the struggle against ecologically unsustainable and unjust capitalist development. Erom Sharmila, force-fed under arrest of over 11 years by the Indian state, as she continues her fast for the repeal of the Armed Forces Special Powers Act the law that enables her state of Manipur and the northeast of India in general to be treated as occupied territory. Mayawati, the Dalit leader of one of the most powerful organizations of Dalits in India, the Bahujan Samaj Party, to name but three. On the other hand, there is active participation by women in Hindu right-wing and upper caste anti-reservation politics, ecological movements and land struggles, as well as in armed Maoist movements. All these can be and have been studied from a feminist point of view, but that is not my project here, because here I limit myself to engaging only with ideas and activism that themselves directly address gendered modes of power today. I would like to place here a contrary opinion to complicate the distinction I make between feminism and women in movements. Nalini Nayak, who works with Fisher People's Movements on issues of livelihood and ecological sustainability, terms ecological movements the resource base of our feminism. She is suggesting that the two cannot be so neatly separated. Clearly, as feminists, we must engage politically with such movements. But only for the purposes of this one small book, I will maintain the conceptual distinction. For the same reasons of space and clarity of argument, I do not go into the history of feminism in India, which goes back to the 19th century, and about which there is a large body of scholarship, to some of which you will find references at different points in the book. I have largely focused on the contemporary moment, addressing history only in order to show the process of emergence of features we see in the present. My overall understanding of Indian politics is always part of the background and has been more fully outlined in an earlier work co-written with Aditya Nigam, Power and Contestation, 2007. There, we see the twin projects of the Indian elite, that of nation and capital, being militantly challenged and subverted by a variety of contestations, some of which are also in direct confrontation with one another. While that book too adopted a feminist lens to look at Indian politics, this book focuses directly on questions arising from the gendered nature of power. This book is divided into six chapters that tackle what I see as key interrelated themes. A quick note for the listener fortunate enough to have escaped stodgy academic training, the text is scattered with reference to other books and articles. But these names and dates in brackets and the notes at the end may be skipped completely. They are there because I want to make it clear that my own argument emerges in conversation with feminist politics everywhere, and because some listeners may want to follow up, but you can also let your eye filter them out. And
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.